done unto thee. In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. In our epistle, we are told that if our enemy is hungry, we should feed him. And if our enemy is thirsty, we should give him drink. We are told to overcome evil with good. Well, that's impossible. Whoops. As thou hast believed, so be it done unto thee. Impossible unless I believe otherwise. Kind of silly, don't you think? This pre-modern thinking, written at a time when the world was still enchanted, in an age of superstition. As thou hast believed, so be it done unto thee. This is what Jesus says to the centurion who begged Jesus to heal his servant. Why, sure, says Jesus, let's go. Oh no, says the centurion, simply speak the word and my servant shall be healed. After Jesus does indeed speak the word and the servant is healed in the selfsame hour, Jesus says to the centurion, and he says to us, as thou hast believed, so be it done unto thee. If only it were true, but how shall we know? Well, there's the trap. As long as we don't believe, it won't be done unto us. Only if we believe will we come to know whether it is true or not. As thou hast believed, so be it done unto thee. Our two miracle stories in our gospel today are only of interest to those of us for whom our flesh and our body is important. And that seems like a rhetorical sort of thing to say. I've had a couple conversations this week with young students here on, and they told me in no uncertain terms that their flesh and their body is not important to them. Got me thinking. If you're hell-bent on waiting for technology to get to the point that your brain can be hooked up to a machine and you can live for 1,000 years, or you can live for 100,000 years with your memory and your identity intact somehow, become part of that machine that will never wear out, then these miracle stories mean nothing to you. They're not interesting. But for somebody like me, flesh is where I live. Flesh is how we learn through these bits of flesh called eyes and ears and vocal cords. Flesh is how we communicate. Our flesh doesn't get in the way of learning or living or loving. Our flesh is the very way of learning and living and loving. The opposite of flesh is not spirit. The opposite of flesh is stone. And if this was to be live streamed now, which it isn't, and if any of your parents were watching, they would hear in their voice, and a rock feels no pain in an island. It's pretty clear why we might actually desire and prefer to have stony hearts. The students made it clear to me this week. Our fleshly hearts make us uncomfortable. Flesh is what hurts. The Jewish scriptures and the Christian gospel promise to give us hearts of flesh. Well, what kind of promise is that? Oh yes, we are more than flesh, that's for sure. Much more, eternally more. Yet this more is found only in and through the fragile flesh, through our hearts of flesh. John Donne wrote, love's mysteries in souls do grow, but yet the body is his book. Love's mysteries in souls do grow, and yet the body is his book. As thou hast believed, so be it done unto thee. Epiphany is the season of manifestation, of revelation, that the Word was made flesh, that the Word made flesh was truly Word, ineffable God, truly God, and truly flesh, truly our flesh. And so, when this Word made flesh begins his ministry in Galilee, the first thing he does is he climbs a mountain. And he speaks most wonderfully. If you're looking for those purple passages, this is where you'll find it in these chapters of Matthew. It's just before this eighth chapter. And you'll find the Beatitudes. Blessed are the poor in spirit. Blessed are those who mourn. They will be comforted. Blessed are the meek. They shall inherit the earth. Blessed are those who thirst. And then after the Beatitude, the wonderful teaching and the Lord's Prayer. And after all that beautiful teaching, our gospel for today picks up the thread as he was coming down from the mountain. Word made flesh. As he was coming down from the mountain, he met a leper. And the leper is contagious. It's the nature of the disease. That's why the book of Leviticus prescribes for the leper. He will wear torn clothes and disheveled hair. He will cover his beard and cry out in front of him, impure, impure, unclean, unclean. Well, does the leper actually ask for healing in our gospel? This is what we're told. And behold, a leper came and worshipped him, saying, Kyrie, if thou wilt, thou canst make me clean. Lord, if thou wilt, thou canst make me clean. As thou hast believed, so be it done unto thee. If it be your will to let me sing from this broken hill, all your praises they shall ring. If it be your will to let me sing, thy will be done. Jesus put forth his hand and touched him. Now, only a fool would touch a leper in the ancient world when contagious was believed to be instantaneous. But this is why the Word was made flesh. And he touches the leper and he says two words, Thelo, Katharispeti, be cleansed. He says to the leper, be restored to community through your body. Well, our second miracle teaches us how to pray. The centurion approaches Jesus and asks him for nothing for himself. He bears in himself somebody else's misery, somebody who is grievously tormented. A paralyzed boy lies at home, terribly tortured, the Greek says, by his affliction. And there was screaming. There were a lot of it. Okay, says Jesus, I'll come. And now the centurion puts Jesus in his place and teaches us how to do the same. He says this, Lord, I am not worthy that thou shouldst come under my roof, but speak the word only, and my servant shall be healed. One word in Genesis, and light was created. One word now, and the servant will be healed. One word made flesh. Well, in Advent, we cried out with Pagans and Jews and philosophers and seekers for truth and redemption, O come wisdom, O come righteousness, O come redeemer. And the ancient pagans and Gentiles and Jews and philosophers had no idea what they were crying out for. And we had no idea what to expect, for it was unimaginable. And what came to them and what came to us was the Word made flesh. And thus we are discovering that the spiritual path ahead of us into the life of God, no matter what you thought before this Christianity was about, the spiritual path ahead of us is a path toward and into the flesh. Not away from it. Into fragility. Not away from it. We seek a fleshly heart, not a stony heart. And that is enough to scare most of us away. We offer ourselves, our souls and bodies, to be a living sacrifice. Well, we can only learn to love this world through our bodies, but I will stop there. For that will be the teaching of the whole rest of the Christian year. If you sign up for that journey, of course, there's no reason that you should believe that our bodies are meant to become holy and glorious flesh. You might rather that your brain become part of a machine that would offer you another kind of eternal life. I can give you no reason to believe. But until we believe, we shall never.